Good morning. Standing out here in the snow, it's beginning to look and to feel a lot like Christmas. And one of the emotions that we associate with Christmas is the emotion of joy. And where do you get joy? And especially in the year 2020, where do you get joy? You know, the Bible says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And so today we're going to look at that emotion of joy and ask the question from the scriptures, where do we receive it? Where do we receive an emotion of joy from Christ himself? And so I'm excited for us to have this time of worship together. And I want to pray that God would lead us into this experience of worshiping him. So would you join me and we'll pray. Father, would you pour out upon us an eagerness to encounter you in our hearts through the scriptures. In Jesus' name, amen.
We sing hallelujah. We sing. Hi, my name is Matt. I'm the student pastor here. Thanks for joining us. If you have a Bible, go grab it. We are going to be in Psalm 100 this morning. Let me ask you something. Are you feeling joy or are you feeling frustrated? Frustrated that we moved online? Frustrated and unhappy about the results of the election? Unsatisfied with your current work situation? Maybe even discouraged by your relationship situation or your financial situation? I think we all want to feel joy. I think we all want to be a joyful person, especially around Christmas. No one wants to be a Scrooge or a Mr. Potter, but the way that we tend to think about joy is that when things are going our way, that's when we will feel joy. When our circumstances are good, that's when we will be happy and have joy. But that isn't how the Bible really talks about joy. To the Bible, joy is something that you can feel in your soul regardless of circumstance. And God wants you to feel joy. God wants you to feel this emotion in all circumstances, when things are going well and when things are not ideal, when things go your way and when things don't go your way, when things go perfectly as planned and when they don't go as planned. God wants you to feel joy, not just during the good seasons of life, but in every circumstance. And I'm gonna read Psalm 100, and I'm gonna build out a definition of what the Bible speaks to joy being. And I'm gonna circle around three different ideas about joy. And it's this: joy is happiness, joy is commanded, and joy is possible. And so here's Psalm 100. It's gonna help us out to that. And it says, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us. We are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever and his faithfulness to all generations." This is the word of the Lord. Would you pray it with me? God, would you speak into our lives right now with joy? And may we come to know this deep abiding, soul-filled happiness that's found in you. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Okay, so first thing, joy is happiness. If you look at verse 1, the psalmist could have easily written, "Make a noise to the Lord, serve the Lord, come into his presence." But instead, what is written is a command that's attached to a feeling. It's the psalmist wanting you to feel something. He says, "Make a joyful noise, serve the Lord with gladness, come into his presence with singing." What the writer is doing, he's connecting the command to a happy feeling. It's cheer, it's gladness. And actually, those commands don't really have to do much with singing, but rather, in the Hebrew, those things are tied up to like shouts of acclamations like you would do at like a political rally or around a king, or even a sporting event when your team wins. It's these shouts of joy, your arms throwing up into the air and yelling. Or it's kind of like my son with the snow that we just had this week. It was beautiful. It was amazing. And this week when I was shoveling our driveway, we have this huge window in the front of our house, and my son will sit on or stand on our ottoman, and he'll put his hands on the window and he'll just watch out into the world. And when I was shoveling, I noticed him. And so I would shovel, but I would throw up the snow into the air. And he screamed and was laughing with that three-year-old joyful laugh. That is a joyful noise. He was happy, right? He was feeling good and he was smiling. And so our definition is joy is happiness. But happiness isn't always marked with shouts and laughter like my son did. Some of the happiest moments and most joy-filled moments move people to tears. One of the happiest and most joyful days of my life is when I got married. When my wife was walking down the aisle to me, I was filled with joy and happiness, and I was moved to tears. How often do we see athletes who are at the top of their game? They win their championship and they're so elated, they're happy, and they cry. Have you seen those videos where soldiers, they come home and they surprise their loved ones? Like it so moves them to tears, but it also like can convey happiness even to you, that even people who watch it are like, "Man, every time I watch those videos, I cry." Sometimes in their joy, people dance and laugh and they shout. Sometimes in their joy, people cry and they fall to their knees. Sometimes in their joy, people show no outer emotion other than a smile or maybe even a blush in their cheeks. But everyone has felt a rush of happiness, a rush of joy in their lives. I don't have to explain what that is, what that feels like to you, because everyone and anyone can experience this good feeling in their soul. Anyone can experience joy because joy is not limited to Christians. All people can feel a type of joy, some type of joy, because all people are made in the image of God, who is himself joyful. Now, to some, God has a bad reputation of being a fun sucker, like one of those Dementors from Harry Potter, in that he just wants to rob out and suck all happiness and life from you by the rules and the do's and the do-nots that you have to do. But 13th century priest Thomas Aquinas once said that God is happiness by his essence. For he is happy not by acquisition or participation of something else, but by his essence, happiness. Theologian Richard Mueller said that God is essentially blessed and happy. Where do they get that? Well, one of the places is Zephaniah 3:17 tells us that the Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save you. And it says, he will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing. God is a mighty one in your presence, rejoicing over you with gladness. Jesus said in John 15 that he wants his joy in us so that our joy may be full. Joy is happiness that anyone can feel because we are made in the image of a God who is happy, blessed, and joyful. The problem that people experience, though, is that while everyone can taste that kind of joy, that sense of joy, that winning championships, that wedding, that being promoted or having financial stability, like whatever circumstance that might bring people happiness and joy, those things are like hors d'oeuvres at a party. They may taste really good, but there are never enough and they always run out. That's why people are always chasing after the next thing to bring them happiness, because happiness runs out. It's why people leave their marriages to find a new spouse. It's why people buy new cars and trinkets. Happiness, there's a type of happiness that can run out. And so, let me pause and just ask specifically, those people who wouldn't identify as Christians, if you can be honest with yourselves, with these two questions, answer them for yourselves. What are you running to for joy and happiness? And what will you do if that thing runs out? What are you running to for happiness and joy? And what will you do when that thing runs out? Because for the Christian, there is a type of joy, a spiritual happiness that marks them, that seems to not run dry. It seems to not stop. It seems to be eternal in some way. And why is that? Well, it's because the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is producing this joy in you. God is producing the fruit of the Spirit in you, this particular fruit of the Spirit, joy in your life. It's one of the fruit of the Spirit. It's that the believer, for the believer, joy is supernaturally being produced in your life. Christians are marked, they're identified, they are known by their joy. And so for the Christian, let me define joy for you this way. Spiritual joy is a good feeling of happiness that is produced by the Holy Spirit. You cannot have the Christian life without joy. It is essential. How do I know this? Well, it's a fruit of the Spirit, like I already said. So we are to be marked by it. Like you know a tree by its fruit. And so you know a Christian by the fruit of the Spirit, one of them being joy. But we are also commanded to have joy. In Scripture, we see this word rejoice. In Psalm 97:12, it says, rejoice in the Lord. Psalm 32:11 says, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. In the New Testament, it says, in Romans 12:15, rejoice with those who rejoice. That's a command. 2 Corinthians 13:11, finally, brothers, rejoice. Rejoice always, 1 Thessalonians 5 tells us. Philippians 2:18 says, be glad with me and rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice, Philippians 4:4 says. And so to rejoice is to show joy or show happiness, right? Rejoicing is choosing to show or act in my happiness, in my joy, in this Spirit-produced joy. It's a command. We are commanded to show our joy, to act in our joy. And so to me, that's a little bit odd that the Bible would command our joy. And so I have to think, why? Why is happiness commanded? Well, if joy is happiness that is produced by the Holy Spirit, why would it be commanded? Because joy is the fitting response in the receiver to the goodness of the giver, right? Because of the goodness of the giver, for those that are receiving, rejoicing is the right response. Joy is the right response. Look at verse 3. It says, know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us. We are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. One of the reasons why the Bible is so relentless in commanding our joy, it is because of the goodness of God. The action for us to have joy and to rejoice is based upon not your current circumstance, not your current situation, but because of the goodness of God, based on who God is. Deuteronomy 26:11 says this, you shall rejoice in all the good that the Lord your God has given you. Right? Spiritual joy in the heart of the believer corresponds to the goodness in the heart of the Creator. And so to flesh out this definition of joy even more, spiritual joy is happiness produced by the Holy Spirit as we focus on the goodness of God. Joy, something marked, that we're marked by the Holy Spirit, but also commanded to feel. Now, let me just be open with you in this way. Oftentimes, I am not joyful. I am emotionally inconsistent, and at times, for seasons, I am spiritually dull. At times, I feel like I'm riding a roller coaster of emotions and go from spiritual highs down to spiritual lows. It's like I'm the weather in central Pennsylvania in the fall, where one day it can be 70 and then the next day it can be 30 degrees. At times, joy can seem so natural, like it's a fountain of joy just being produced in my life, that it's turned on and my bucket is just receiving and overflowing. And then there are times and seasons and rhythms of life that are just dry, that are marked with joylessness. And I don't think I'm alone in saying that. I think you know what that's like. I think as you hear me say that, you can look back on seasons, and maybe you're in a season now that is marked with joylessness. And so hear me. So you hear that as a Christian, we're supposed to be marked by joy, and we're commanded. We ought to feel happiness in the Lord. And this is a command, but you hear me say that it's a command, and that can be burdensome because you just don't feel it. It's burdensome rather than life-giving. And in the midst of the cold, and in the midst of these dreary days between Thanksgiving and Christmas, that can just naturally bring feelings of depression and sadness and loneliness. In the midst of a world growing farther apart and church moving online, things not going our way, in the midst of remembering loved ones not with us, in the midst of constant family arguments and financial stress, the Bible says to be joyful, that can feel burdensome. But let me give you some good news. Joy is possible. You can really feel it. It is really offered to you this morning. How? Look at Psalm 100 with me again, verses 4 and 5. It says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name." Here it is. Verse 5, "For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." You are to be joyful, not because your circumstances deem it, but because the Lord's goodness is constant. Because God's steadfast love, because of his faithfulness, endures forever to all generations. Christian, let me summarize joy again, and how we experience the goodness of God in these verses in four words, right? The goodness of God in four words, so that you can feel joy. God is for you. God is for you. Spiritual joy is a soul-filled happiness in the Lord that is produced by the Holy Spirit as we remember that God is for us. That we remember that God is for us. And in this passage, I see eight things that you can hold on to help you in feeling joyful in every circumstance. So let me highlight them for you. If you have a pen and if you have a Bible, what I would do is I would just put a number next to the thing that I say, okay, that God made you. It says that God made you. He made you. You should have joy because you right now have life in your veins. You just took a breath. You are still here. So be happy that God made you and you are still here, number one. Number two, look at the word Lord. It's all capitalized. When in the Old Testament you see Lord all capitalized like that, that's the Bible translators, like the ones that we have, telling you that in the original language, Hebrew, this is God's personal name, Yahweh. That God has a personal name, and it's first revealed to Moses in the Exodus account. When we see Lord, capital Lord, we're supposed to remember all that this is his personal name, but all that comes with that, that he saves his people, that God made himself known to us as Yahweh when he saved his people from Egypt. All that to say, God saved you. Be joyful that you aren't your old sinful self anymore, that God doesn't relate to you that way. Be happy that God doesn't berate you as a sinner and your old self, but he relates to you as a new creation, a righteous person, a saved person. Number three, he families you. Yes, I made up a word there, but God puts you in a family. It says that we are his people. You may not like the family that you're with all the time. You might not utilize your new family like you ought to, but these are messages for different days. God says, be joyful that God puts you in a family as a Christian. Be happy that you don't have to do life anymore. Number four, he shepherds you. We are the sheep of his pasture. Even as you walk through the valley of shadow of death, you don't have to be afraid. Why? Because you can rejoice because God is with you. God is your shepherd and he guides you into paths of righteousness. Number five, he is good to you. God is good. God works all things for our good and his glory, and his goodness is him being for you. And so we can be joyful that God is for us, not against us. Number six, God has steadfast love for you. God really does care about you. And because he really cares about you, you can cast all your anxiety onto him. You can be joyful because he is for you. You can be happy because he loves you, not because you are good or lovely. In fact, it's despite those things. You aren't lovely. You aren't good. And as a sinner, you were in open rebellion to God and in deserving of eternal separation from his presence in hell. And despite your rebellion, God the Father sent his son Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured torture and pain on the cross. What was his joy? What was Jesus' joy? The joy set before Jesus was that you and I would be redeemed and reconciled back to God. And in love and in joy, he endured pain, the pains of punishment for your sins and my sin, so that God's love could reconcile us and bring us back to himself. God's love for you is so great and so steadfast that he was willing to send his son as your substitute on the cross so that he would receive the punishment for your sin and that you would receive the goodness, the good gift of the life that Jesus earned with his life. And not only that, because of God's love is for you, you can know that God is rejoicing over you with gladness and singing. God has steadfast love for you. He loves you because he loves you, period. Number seven, this love endures forever. It's very hard to be loved on your worst day, but God's love for you endures forever. God has proven his love for you on your worst day. And so you can be joyful that when you experience the worst days, that when you experience sin in your life, when you act in sin, you cannot experience any less of his love and you won't experience any more of his love because he's already proven it to you definitively. He's shown you how much he loves you. He sent his son Jesus to die for you. Number eight, he is faithful to you. Be happy and be filled with joy that God will never leave you and never forsake you. Be filled with joy that even when you're not faithful, God remains faithful to you. Even when you don't feel joy, God is rejoicing over you with gladness. And since it's Christmas, I'm going to give you one more gift. I'm going to give you one more. It's not in this passage. It's actually found in Psalm 16:11. It says, "In God's presence, there is fullness of joy." Let me ask you, are we in God's presence? No. In this life, we will not get to experience the fullness of spiritual joy because we are not in God's presence. But we celebrate this week a holiday that says that God came to be with us, that the fullness of God, Jesus, was born to be with us. His name, Emmanuel, God with us. Luke 2:10-11 says that the angels told the shepherds, "Fear not, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Here is good news that should make you be filled with joy, to make you happy. A Savior was born to be with you, to show you just how much God is for you. But Christmas isn't just about a celebration of when he was born. Christmas and Advent, these seasons that we celebrate, are a season of hopeful, joyful anticipation about Christ's return, about his second coming. And so reason 9 that we can have joy, Jesus' words in John 16:22. So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, Jesus promises. And your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take that joy from you. Jesus has promised that he will come back and return for you. This is not the end. The best is yet to come. And so be joyful today that there is a day coming where your joy, your spiritual joy, will be complete when you are in the presence of God. Joy here is just a taste of the greatest joy that is to come. When we rejoice now, even especially now in our suffering, we do so knowing that a greater rejoicing and greater happiness will come when Jesus comes back. Peter writes that we are to rejoice insofar as you share in Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. I think we all can know these things in our mind. Like, we can know those 9 things to be true for us, but not yet feel it in our soul. And so why do we struggle? Why do we struggle with spiritual joy at times? And I think it's because that there's persistence in sin and our refusal to repent. Like, when we do that, when we continue to walk in sin and we refuse to repent, we don't feel joy. How do I know that? Well, it's like King David. King David, who willfully walked in sin, not just light sin either. He walked in choosing to commit adultery and to murder. And what were the effects on him? Well, he went without joy. But we hear David's words in Psalm 51 and how he confesses and what he prays for. He says this: "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love." And for his confession, David, he's going to appeal to the same reason that we should have joy. He says this: "Wash me, I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins. Blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me." In verse 12, his prayer: "Restore to me the joy of your salvation." He prays for forgiveness of sins and asks God to restore to him the joy of salvation. If you don't feel spiritual joy, examine your life. Examine your heart. See if there is any offensive ways or sin within you. Examine your life and your heart and confess those sins to God. Appeal to his steadfast love that he would forgive you, and maybe even confess your lack of joy. It is a command. And so to not feel it, we should confess that we don't feel it. Maybe repent of it too. Ask him to give you a clean heart. Ask him to restore the joy of your salvation, because God wants you to be joyful because he's rejoicing over you now. So ask him. Ask him to restore the joy of your salvation to you. But don't just leave it there. Seek after the Lord. Refresh your mind with the goodness of God. Remember that God is for you, and seek after ways to reignite your heart for God by finding him through the scriptures. However you're finding this morning, we'll put up a link, and it's a link to a free Advent devotional to help you focus in on Jesus and experience spiritual joy, to experience this happiness in the Lord that is produced by the Spirit when we know that God is for us. I hope that you would take up that offer to read that Advent devotional. Because Christian, in every circumstance, remember that God is for you and not against you. And feel happy to know that God is for you. It's essential, it's commanded, and it's possible. So let's pray. God, would you fill us with joy today? Would you produce it within our soul by your Holy Spirit as we consider Jesus, who is for us and not against us? It's in his name I pray. Amen. Do you remember what the shepherds were told by the angel? This is good news of great joy for who? All people. And if you're hearing me, let me ask you, what's holding you back from receiving this great love and being filled with this spiritual joy? What's holding you back? Because this is good news of great joy, that the God who made you is offering salvation and family and steadfast love and provision and guidance and hope. This God who made you is offering you joy, spiritual joy. This God is for you and not against you. And if you believe it, if you have faith in his son, Jesus, who he sent to be with you, and if you believe in him, that then you will come to know this spiritual joy produced by the Holy Spirit within us. You will come to know that the best joy is not found here in this world, but in him in the next. So let me ask you, what's holding you back from receiving Jesus as your Savior this Christmas? Because if it's a lesser joy, if it's a lesser means of happiness, if it's something that's not going to bring you everlasting joy, eternal, lasting happiness, throw it aside. Throw it away and believe in Jesus and experience in your soul the feeling of deep joy that is found in him alone. May God bless you and give you this joy.
Matt, thank you for that teaching from the scripture. I think it is so important for us to look to the Lord for our sense of joy. And my prayer is that the Lord would restore to us the joy of our salvation, and that we would actively rejoice in him, that we would receive as a gift his grace, which is the source of our joy. And now as we close out the service, let me just remind you that Christmas Eve services will be on the website, also on YouTube and on Facebook. And we'll have something for the children also on our website and on YouTube. And so you can tune in there on Christmas Eve for an opportunity to engage in worship together. And if you'd like to give, of course, you can go to the website to participate in that act of worship as well. And I pray God's blessing on you. May he fill you with his joy in Jesus' name.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and sing, and heaven and nature sing. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, 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 wonders of his love. Joy to the world.